Socrates next deprecates the prejudice against him by explaining its origin. Chaerephonta ga istepu, hutos emoste heterasein ek neu, kai himun to plethe heteroste, kai xinefigetein figein tautein, kai methumun kat eothe. Kai este de hoios ein chaerephon, hos fod dros e fotio mesie. Kai de pote kai eis dolfus elthon, et tolmes et tuto manchusus thai. Kai hoper lego, methor beteo andres, ere to god de etis emu e eis ophoteras, anelen un hepithia, me denas ophoteran enai. Kai tuton peri, ho adolfos himin autu, hutosi martyrese, epede kenos teteluteken. Skepsas the de hon henica tauta lego, melo ga humas didaxein, hothen moi he diabole gegene, tauta ga ego acusas, en ethumumen hutosi, tipote lege hotheos, kai tipote ainititai. Ego ga de ute me ga utes micron xinoidae hem autos ophos on, tion pote lege fascone me so fortaton enae, uga de pupsuditae ge, uga themis auto. Kai polun men chronon e porun, ti pote lege, epeta mogis panu epizetis in aututo iautintina et rapomen. Eothon epitina ton docunton sophonenae, hosentautha, e per pu elenxon to manteon, cae apophanon to chresmo hoti hautosi, emu sophoteras esti, sude eme efesta. Diascopon un tuton, onomati gaudendeo malegen, einde tiston politikon, pros han ego scopon to iauton ti epathon, o Andres Athenaioi. Kai dialegomenos auto, eroxe moi hutos hoanea docain men enae sophos, aloiste polois anthropois, kai malista he auto, enae de u. Capetae piromen auto dic nunae, hoti oioito men enae sophos, e de u. Entuthen un tuto te apecthomen, kai polois ton paranton, prosem auton de un apion elogit zomen, hoti tutum mentu anthropu, ego sophoteros emi. Cindu nue men ga himon udeteras, uden callon cagathon e denae, al hutos men oietae ti e denae, uc e dos, ego de hos perun uc oida, ud oiomai. Eoi cagun tutu ges microtini auto tuto sophoteras enae, hoti hame oida ude oiomai e denai. Entuthen, ep alon ea tone kenu docunton sophoteron enai, camoi tauta tauta edoxe, ca entautha ca kenu ca alois polois apecthomen. Meta tauta un ede efexes ea, aisthanomenos men cae lupumenos cae de dios hoti apecthanomen, homos de anancaion edoce eina totu theu periples dupoiestai. Et tean un scopunti ton chresmon ti lege, epi happantas tusti docuntas e denae. Cae ne ton cina, o Andres Athenaioi, dega prosumas tale thelegein, emen ego epathon ti tuoton. Hoemen malista iudoce muntes edoxan moi oligu dein tu pleiston ende eis enae zetunti cataton theon, aloide docuntes faloteroi, epi ecesteroi enae Andres pros to phronimos. You must have known Chaerephon. He was early a friend of mine, and also a friend of your democracy, for he shared in the recent exile of the people and returned with you. Well, Chaerephon, as you know, was very impetuous in all his doings, and he went to Delphi and boldly asked the oracle to tell him whether, as I was saying, I must beg you not to interrupt, he asked the oracle to tell him whether anyone was wiser than I was, and the Pythian prophetess answered that there was no man wiser. Chaerephon is dead himself, but his brother, who is in court, will confirm the truth of what I am saying. Why do I mention this? because I'm going to explain to you why I have such an evil name. When I heard the answer, I said to myself, what can the god mean, and what is the interpretation of his riddle? For I know that I have no wisdom, small or great. What then can he mean when he says that I am the wisest of men? And yet he is a god and cannot lie. That would be against his nature. After long consideration, I thought of a method of trying the question. I reflected that if I could only find a man wiser than myself, then I might go to the god with a refutation in my hand. I should say to him, here is a man who is wiser than I am, but you said that I was the wisest. Accordingly, I went to one who had the reputation of wisdom and observed him. His name I need not mention. He was a public figure whom I selected for examination, and the result was as follows. When I began to talk with him, I could not help thinking that he was not really wise, though he was thought wise by many and still wiser by himself. And thereupon I tried to explain to him that he thought himself wise, but was not really wise. The consequence was that he hated me, and his enmity was shared by several who were present and heard me. So I left him, saying to myself as I went away, well, although I do not suppose that either of us knows anything really fine and good, I am better off than he is, for he knows nothing and thinks that he knows. I neither know nor think that I know. In this latter particular, then, I seem to have slightly the advantage of him. Then I went to another who had still higher pretensions to wisdom, and my conclusion was exactly the same. Whereupon I made another enemy of him, and of many others besides him. Then I went to one man after another, being conscious of the enmity which I provoked, and I lamented and feared this, but necessity was laid upon me. The word of the God, I thought, ought to be considered first. And I said to myself, go I must to all who appear to know, and find out the meaning of the oracle. And I swear to you, Athenians, by the dog I swear, for I must tell you the truth, the result of my mission was just this. I found that the men most in repute were all but the most foolish, and that others less esteemed were really wiser and better. I will tell you the tale of my wanderings, and of the Herculean labors, as I may call them, which I endured, only to find at last the oracle irrefutable. After the politicians, I went to the poets, tragic, dithyrambic, and all sorts. And there I said to myself, you will instantly be detected. Now you will find out that you are more ignorant than they are. Accordingly, I took some of the most elaborate passages in their own writings and asked what was the meaning of them, thinking that they would teach me something. Will you believe me? I am almost ashamed to confess the truth, but I must say that there is hardly a person present who would not have talked better about their poetry than they did themselves. Then I knew that not by wisdom do poets write poetry, but by a sort of genius and inspiration. They are like diviners or soothsayers, who also say many fine things, but do not understand the meaning of them. The poets appear to me to be much in the same case, and I further observed that upon the strength of their poetry they believed themselves to be the wisest of men in other things, in which they were not wise. So I departed, conceiving myself to be superior to them for the same reason that I was superior to the politicians. At last I went to the artisans, for I was conscious that I knew nothing at all, as I may say, and I was sure that they knew many fine things. And here I was not mistaken, for they did know many things of which I was ignorant, and in this they certainly were wiser than I was. But I observed that even the good artisans fell into the same errors as the poets. Because they were good workmen, they thought that they also knew all sorts of high matters, and this defect in them overshadowed their wisdom. And therefore I asked myself, on behalf of the oracle, whether I would like to be as I was, neither having their knowledge nor their ignorance, or like them in both. And I made answer to myself and to the oracle that I was better off as I was. This investigation led to my having many enemies of the worst and most dangerous kind, and has given occasion also to many calumnies. And I am called a wise man, for my hearers always imagine that I myself possess the wisdom which I find wanting in others. But perhaps the truth is, men of Athens, that the god is really wise, and by his answer he intends to show that the wisdom of men is worth little or nothing. He is not speaking of Socrates, he is only using my name by way of illustration, as if he said, he, you human beings, is the wisest, who, like Socrates, knows that his wisdom is in truth worth nothing. And so I go about the world obedient to the God, and search and make inquiry into the wisdom of anyone, whether citizen or stranger, who appears to be wise. And if he is not wise, then in vindication of the oracle I show him that he is not wise. And my occupation quite absorbs me, and I have no time to give either to any public matter of interest or to any concern of my own, but I am in utter poverty by reason of my devotion to the God. There is another thing. Young men of the richer classes who have not much to do come about me of their own accord. They like to hear the pretenders examined, and they often imitate me and proceed to examine others. There are plenty of persons, as they quickly discover, who think that they know something but really know little or nothing. And then those who are examined by them, instead of being angry with themselves, are angry with me. This confounded Socrates, they say, this villainous misleader of youth. And then if somebody asks them, why, what evil does he practice or teach, they do not know and cannot tell. But in order that they may not appear to be at a loss, they repeat the ready-made charges which are used against all philosophers about teaching things up in the clouds and under the earth and having no gods and making the worse argument appear the stronger. For they do not like to confess that their pretense of knowledge has been detected, which is the truth. And as they are numerous and ambitious and energetic, they speak earnestly and persuasively about me and have filled your ears with their loud and inveterate calumnies.